Welcome to the middle of the Greater Kruger National Park. Within a few miles of us, there's a pride of lions we're searching for. So come join us on the adventure. This is Safari Live.
Ready.
Standing by.
Welcome again to the middle of the African bushveld. My name is Brent Leo Smith. I have the incredible Vim on camera with me today, and we're in search for our dominant female pride of lions. They are called the Nkahuma Pride. They currently have 8 cubs, 5 females, and there's always the possibility of a Birmingham boy, one of the dominant males in this area, being around. So they gave us a bit of a run around on the Sunrise Safari, tracks crisscrossing the reserve. But we're fairly confident that some point on the Sunset Safari, we're gonna get a bit of luck. So the last set of tracks of those females and cubs crossed through this open area. Now I'm just making sure they didn't do an oop-de-loop and disappear back down behind us. I think they've gone to the north. It's an area they've been favoring while they have young cubs. Lots of really good little ravines for them to hide the cubs in. And if you would like to know anything about lions or lion cubs, or in fact anything we come across while on these live African safaris, pop us a question. Questions at wildearth.tv is the email address, or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Now it's quite warm, 27 degrees Celsius, 82 Fahrenheit, and we're still in winter, but we are in August. So the winds are blowing, so there's a bit of a strong breeze, so we're going to have to concentrate extra hard to find you fantastic things. But that's half the fun of being out in the African bush and live. We literally cannot predict at all what we're going to see or what's going to happen. We can have an idea, but literally one of the most fun things is to be proved wrong on a daily basis by the incredible wildlife of Africa. Speaking of such wildlife, there is an animal. Yeah, a male impala, and with this strong breeze, a lot of the prey species or herbivores like that impala are going to be a little bit more jumpy. So not quite as relaxed as if there wasn't any wind. Now the wind affects their smell and their hearing, making it sometimes a little bit easier for the predators to creep up on them. Now this gentleman is chewing the cud. Oh, and was watching us, listening quite intently, but you see he's always on high alert. He doesn't know if there's a lion or a leopard around the corner, or whether there could be a cheetah speeding up to him. And a warm welcome from the middle of the African bush to you, Andrew. Andrew would like to know, when did I know I wanted to be a safari guide? Well, Andrew, I was very lucky. I'd pretty much never been in any question what I was going to do. Maybe not specifically a safari guide, but I definitely was always going to work in the African bush. Now, I'm very fortunate in the fact that I've grown up in the African bush, in big 5 areas in South Africa and Botswana, lived in Zambia, Tanzania. And so I've been all over the African bush, and that the only real constant in my life is being, knowing that I wanted to live and work in the African bush. Okay, so I've got a sneaky suspicion that those lions have crossed the Vuyatela access. So we're gonna go check very carefully along that road. While we do that, let's go see Mr. Hendry, who's got one of the fluffier antelopes around.
You can't believe it, everybody. You won't believe what we found. Brian, it is a...
waterbuck.
Well done, a waterbuck, everyone. This morning we found only impala, that was all, and now the great rarity of Cobus elipsiprimnus, the great African waterbuck. Now, my name is James Hendry, in case you're wondering. Brian is on camera. Very nice. Brian, what is the thumb today?
A cucumber.
A cucumber. Because one should always draw a cucumber on one's thumb on Saturday, shouldn't one, Brian?
He is so yes. Cool.
He is, I see, cool as a cucumber. Very good. I didn't get it to start with, but now I do. We are as live as Brent is. Please do talk to us during the course of this morning. This morning we managed to find three Impala in 3 hours, but it was kept going. The momentum was maintained by your wonderful questions and conversation, so please keep that up. Hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv. And please also remember to tell us where you're from. We had an incredible drive. I think 2 mornings ago we had some people from Australia, New Zealand. We had someone from Doha. We had various bits and pieces of the world, Romania. And so it's always nice to know where you're from. The bulk of our viewers, of course, in the continental United States, and we'd like to know where you are there as well. Let's go back to the Waterbuck, spend at least an hour with him so that, we've got something to talk about. He's a very, very happily eating on what we call a firebreak area. Now, this particular area is not actually required this year round because we had that big drought, which means that there's not much in the way of fuel load. So were a wildfire to come rushing through this area, which it is wont to do between now and the rainy season, well, this would be a good place from which to fight the fire. But you can see that unless Dante's Inferno was to actually come and set this place ablaze, very little fire is going to make it through here because there's simply no fuel for it to burn. And I say the fire season between now and the rainy season, it's because it's dry. We get these hot northwesterly winds like the one that's blowing now. And then come September and the end of September into October, we start to get lightning strikes from the odd storm that brews. They don't normally drop much water to start with, but they do drop lightning onto the ground, and that can set off a bush blaze. But this year we're pretty safe from that sort of thing. And just to keep you posted, we do have something called the Juma Dam Cam, if you wish to look at it. There are some elephants going there now. I'm thinking about making my way there at some stage, but at the moment we can't go there because there are people still in Vuyatela Camp, and, well, they just don't really want us staring at them while they're having their lunch, do they, Brian?
No,
it's a little awkward when that happens, yeah. When you're enjoying your lobster thermidor for lunch and some fellow is staring at you through the lens of a camera. So I think we'll stick with our waterbuck friend. And then from here, we're going to go off towards Biffleshoek Dam and see what we can find that end. Hello, Hayley. How lovely to hear from you. I'm not sure I've spoken to you before, or certainly not very often. You say, what was the animal at the dam cam? Our very astute bunch in final control, consisting of Geraldine the Cheesecake Kent and Rebecca Congo Christensen, have looked it up, and it was, in fact, an African civet. Now, a civet is a common animal here, except it's only very strictly nocturnal, which means we see their tracks all over the roads during the mornings, but we do not see them much when we're driving around. Sometimes we see them at night. I think I've seen two. Brent's seen a few of them. And so we don't see them very often, but if you do watch the dam cam at night, you will often see something like that. He's a rather magnificent fellow, this waterbuck. He's on his own, of course. He's nowhere near any water. Seldom they are in this area, but they will fight over little water territories if they can. He's obviously irritated his harem of ladies, and they've decided that he's not worth being around right now, so they've gone probably to have some girl time on his own, and they've left him to contemplate the error of contradicting one of the ladies in his harem. Silly, silly, silly man, wouldn't you say, Brian? We all know one doesn't do that, not if one wants to spend a Saturday afternoon anything but alone. Okay, we're going to move on now towards Biffleshoek Dam. I'm just going to reattach the microphone to my back. There we go. Hello, Tucker, you're age just 4, and you want to know from Brian what kind of crayons he uses on his thumb. He actually uses very special kinds of crayons, and I'm going to let him tell you what's going on. Brian?
Use a Copic marker, like a Copic pen, to colour on my thumb with. Yeah.
A Copic marker, but it is xylene free, correct?
Yeah, xylene free, alcohol based, so no worries of causing any damage to my thumb.
Right. So, Tucker, very important, if you're going to draw on your thumb with a Koki pen, it must be xylene free. You must tell your mum that. I'm assuming your mum is watching. Xylene free, which means it won't harm your skin. Good question, that. You can see it is a balmy afternoon. I would submit probably around 26 or 27 degrees Celsius, which is pushing up towards the 80 degree mark in Fahrenheit. That's pretty good going for the end of winter, I think. We have about 2 weeks left of winter as far as we're concerned, and then we'll be into the spring. Right, we're going to drop down a gear and go a little bit faster as we head off to the east towards Biffelzoek Dam. While we do that, let us go and find out how Leo Smith is tracking the lions. You like the Leo and the lions there, Brian? Yes, yes.
So what we're doing at the moment is quite an important part of tracking, and it's called guessing. So I'm thinking it's warm, it's hot, I don't see any tracks there. I'm going to check around towards where, if I was a lion, I might go. So I'm trying to think like a lion, I'm putting myself in the lion's head. And if we get no luck in that area, then we will go back to the last tracks and go take a walk and see if we can find them on foot. But I don't know, I've got a feeling they're in this area somewhere. And one thing I've learned after many, many years in the bush, is always trust your gut. Quite often, you can't explain why, but you go somewhere and the animal happens to be there. Now we're on top of a crest at the moment, or just off the top of a crest. So we're in sort of what you would call really, really prime mixed broad-leafed woodland. Now, we can find lots of different species in this area. We've already seen an impala, kudu, wildebeest, zebra, elephant, buffalo are all prime candidates, steenbok, duiker, to be seen in an area like this. Now, as we dip down towards Sydney's waterhole, there's always a chance that the elephants might be taking advantage of this heat of the day to go down for a drink. Hi, Karen, who's the Zimbo in London. Karen is wondering, can I confirm the Sticks of Pride has 8 cubs? What are their sexes? They do have 8 cubs. There was a while where people thought maybe 2 cubs had been lost, but all 8 have turned up. And I'm not 100% sure on this, but as far as I remember, the Sticks sexes are 6 males and 2 females. So a very male-dominated litter for the Sticks Pride. Okay. Now, there's always a good chance, remember, lions don't like to move around too much during the heat of the day, but if something happens to stumble upon them, they might. And the one rule you always know is that if in the bush is to expect the unexpected. So normally they don't walk during the day, but who's to say that today they didn't? Double check this northern boundary. Pop through to the waterhole, we'll have a quick look there. Now, also, this quite strong breeze we're experiencing this evening is going to keep a lot, as I said, the herbivores a bit more skittish. So it's even harder to find zebra and giraffe and impala. Well, impala is pretty easy to find, they're all over the place. But they're still going to be a little bit nervous. Now, if you're a lion, you want this breeze to continue through into the dark hours. Fortunately for most of the impala and whatnot, it doesn't. It normally settles a little bit later at this time of the year, but this is our windy part time of the year. let's have a look at the waterhole. I see a shimmering waterhole, but I don't see any large creatures there at the moment. Nope. I was hoping for some elephants. Alas, no luck. Well, let's get back to our lion tracking, and on a positive note, no lion tracks coming out in this area, which means they're definitely still on Juma. Hi Cindy in North Carolina. As we drive through the bush, you'll notice the elephants had pushed down quite a lot of trees, and Cindy's wondering, is any of that wood collected or what is it used for? Very little of it is collected, Cindy, but we do use it for firewood. Other than that, we leave the wood where it is. So if we have a look here, we've got a couple of bits of wood all around us here. Now a fallen log like that is an ecosystem in itself. So the reason we try to minimize the wood we take out of the bush is because that is home now to spiders, scorpions, wood lice, borer beetles, and all sorts of other creatures. So we do try and minimize the amount of wood we collect, and we generally only collect certain species. We leave the rest of the wood out there for all the other creatures. It also creates homes for snakes and for squirrels in certain cases, and dwarf mongoose.
hoping to see some owls, but there are no owls therein. No. Okay. What we're going to do, apparently there are some elephants at the pan, so we're just going to pop around here and see if they haven't crossed this way. Now, Aaron, you ask a very good question about migrant birds and if there are any that I'm looking forward to seeing. Well, I'm looking forward to seeing most of them, but I'm most looking forward to seeing the first ones. And those should be the yellow-billed kites and the Wahlberg's eagles. And I'm slightly surprised that the Wahlberg's haven't come yet. I think we had them, I'm pretty sure we had them by the 10th of August last year. I said 16th yesterday, but I think it may have even been before that. So I'm looking for that flying cross shape in the sky every day. So Wahlberg's very distinctive by its cross-shaped flying shape. Some impala through there, Brian. Yes! Can you believe it? The other thing you won't believe is that the elephants have left. Ah, here they go. We have an elephant and a little baby elephant. This is wonderful. Hello, elephant. You're the first large species of... Oh, this cow looks very, very skinny, everyone. I'm just going to warn you, this might be slightly disturbing. Just get into a position where you can see her nicely. Ugh, she doesn't look that bad, but she doesn't look great. Just look at her hip sticking out there. That's really not nice. It's the worst one I've seen so far. So although they are eating consistently, they're finding, in theory, things to eat. It doesn't look like they're ever walking around with nothing to eat. I think that the nutrients that they need are unquestionably just not around. And so they're really struggling to find the nutrients they need. Let's move a little bit forward. The rest of the herd is down in the bottom of the pan. We can't go onto the dam wall at this stage because there are still guests in the camp. So we'll just go around this side where they can't see us. And we'll get a long range view. There we are. See how cleverly hidden we are, Brian? They can't see us. Unfortunately, we don't have the super zoom camera. Well, that's all right. We get a full frame of elephants. And they're, I think, probably picking up those bits and pieces of green in the bottom of this dam. Now, I'm still astounded by how, when I got here, of course, this dam was full of water. There were hippo, there were things swimming in it all the time. And we went through most of the summer with it dry. Now, that just gives you an idea of the extent to which the drought did affect us. So, yeah, like I've said before, in theory they tell you the warthogs suffer the most from the drought, and I've certainly seen that outside of the reserve, outside one of the reserves on the way to Hoedspruit, really emaciated, dreadful-looking warthogs there. Not here. I haven't seen any skinny warthogs here. The elephants, to me, are the ones that are most obviously suffering from this drought and from the lack of nutrients, and I suspect that they are suffering the consequences of a very poor grass season. Normally in summer they'll eat grass, but they could hardly do that this summer. They were on to winter forage by as early as sort of March. And some of them never got off it. And so that means that the nutrients available in the winter forage of bark and twigs and leaves and pods is that much more denuded. They might also be engaging in a little bit of what we call geophagia, where they're picking up bits and pieces of soil to eat. The soil down here, I suppose, because of the silt that's been brought down in this dam, is probably fairly rich in various nutrients. But we'll see. That was a birchall starling you saw flying off to the right-hand side. And here they've all decided now they're going to go and have a drink. I get the feeling with these elephants, well, with all elephants, that there is a real careful assessment of when and what to do. So I think these little chaps here, you could see they were feeding there, and then the matriarch decided it was safe to go and have a look at the water, and so up they went. But she almost without question gave them an instruction. They didn't just all suddenly start to walk forward like that. There was some kind of communication that went on there. And then, as Jerry says, she's got a view of the dam cam. She said there's another herd that they were possibly talking to. That's also true. I wonder, do we have a shot of them, Jerry, from the front at the dam cam? So I think the zoomie's coming round to focusing on the ones at the water there. And then we'll cut to that view. And they're definitely drinking it from my angle here. I can see them drinking, and that's quite interesting because that water is not the best, but for a long time now there have been no buffalo lying there. There have been no hippo there fouling the water, which means that clearly it's clean enough for them to drink. Oh, Brian, the one in the middle there, that one there on its knees. Can you see it's on its knees there? It's got half a trunk, and that's why it's on its knees. It's having to get right into the water in order to be able to drink. Oh, this is interesting. The zoomie's coming in to have all the elephants in frame, and you'll see the one that I mean with the missing trunk. And drinking twice as fast as the others, and drinking twice as fast because the trunk is obviously half as long, so it holds half the amount. And there you can see that little thing now enjoying its little drink and thinking about possibly having a swim. And it's just like a child playing on building sand. I don't know if you've ever been around a kid in a building site. And he looks like he's going to fall in there. Every time he looks like he's going to fall in, his little tail comes up. Now you see, most of his moisture will be provided by the milk that he's drinking from his mum. So this is more fun for him than it is sort of a necessity. And he just loves playing there in the sand. He enjoys fiddling about in the dust. I don't know if you know what I mean, everybody. When there's a pile of sand, a child will be on it. I was completely unable to stop myself. I'm fairly unable to stop myself even now. When I find a pile of sand, I leap onto it, and I don't know why. But that's exactly what that elephant was doing. Right, now another command has been given. Did you see how they all turned around there? And now you can see they all turned around and faced each other and could well be from... one of them's chasing the other one, I think. I'm not sure that there's actually a real consternation here. I can also see a lot of dust coming out of the middle of the dam. They seem to be a bit spooked by a dust devil there. It's definitely what's happened. A huge cloud of dust blowing over them and making them a little bit nervous. See the little one there thinking about going over the edge there? I'm not sure what they're looking at. I'm just, the dam cam's a bit shaky to cross to now, but Jerry, can you see what they're looking at the other side there? This is probably just that other herd of elephants. Yeah, I think there's probably another herd of elephants there, Jerry's seen. Well, as most of you have seen on the dam cam as well. Oh. Hello, Thomas. Thomas, you're wondering about drought, and of course, as you see that dust flying over, it's a good question to ask. You say, what is the longest drought that this area has ever experienced? I don't know, to be honest, but I can say to you, well, I mean, I'm always slightly suspicious when I hear things like that. They said that last summer was the hottest on record. Again, every winter we have, somebody says, well, you know, of course, this is the coldest winter on record, or this is the hottest summer. So I'm not sure if it was, but the drought has been fairly lengthy. I suspect, you know, a drought in this area, if you go for 2 years of rain like we had this year, you'd be pretty much into the most severe drought that we'd ever had. So if we do not have a good rain season this year, we will be into one of the most severe droughts that we've ever had. It doesn't take much to dry this area out simply because of the lack of water that we get. And we're in what we call a semi-arid area. That means an area where you get between 450 and 600 millimeters of rain. I think that's the definition of it. And an arid area would be anywhere less than sort of 400 millimeters of rain. Now that in inches is about 15 inches or so. Anything less than that, you'd be in the Kalahari semi-desert up in the Karoo regions. But out down here, about 600 millimeters, that's 2 feet of rain. Look, Brian, look. Just look at this crested barbet right here. Can you see it? Mm-hmm. Close by. Check this out. That, everyone. Look. Isn't that awesome? The scruffiest bird out here, but unquestionably one of the most colourful, the crested barbet, humble bird. Many of them around. Oh, look at that. Red and yellow and black and white. I remember, you know, these birds, much like the humble Cape robin when I was in town, when I lived in Johannesburg, I used to put some pawpaw or pepino out every morning when I lived there, and I'd put it outside my bedroom window, and then I'd sit and have my morning coffee, and one of these chaps, or two or three of them, would come and eat the pawpaw, and they'd shout at each other and fight over it. And it was just the most wonderful kind of touch of the wilderness and the wild that a bird like that could live in amongst the mayhem of Johannesburg. The elephants are back drinking now, so whatever it was that alarmed them has ceased to make them scared, and they're now back drinking. And there you can see, I don't know if you can see it there, you probably can, the one on its knees trying to drink with its half trunk. So just keep looking for that one, everyone. I don't think you can see it right now. Probably lost to a snare, I'm afraid. I'm seeing increasing numbers of elephants that have got missing bits of their trunks, and I think they're largely, unfortunately, due to snaring, which I will explain to you. And Karel, you're wondering about the needs of that one with the shortened trunk and whether or not the matriarch is aware of those needs. Yes, I imagine she absolutely is. So in other words, you're saying, would she wait longer? Would they look after it? Would they perhaps give it more time to feed and drink? Yeah, I think absolutely they would. Elephants are known for doing that sort of thing. But it's important to understand, I mean, the snaring thing probably didn't happen in the Kruger itself. There are a number of what we call buffer zones on the side of the Kruger National Park, where there are lots of very poor people living, and they do go into the reserves and set snares illegally, but they set snares to catch things like impala so that they can feed their families. And unfortunately, one of the things that sometimes gets caught in those snares would be elephants while they're feeding. And of course, once an animal gets stuck in a snare, they just pull. They're unable to not sort of panic and pull back. And that's so the snares get very tight, and there's no bone in the trunk, of course. So it really doesn't take very long before you know, the blood will be cut off, the circulation will be cut off, and the trunk itself will just fall off. Must be an incredibly painful thing. Now, they're coming towards us. They're still a good 120 meters or so away. That's about 400 feet. And now they're turning away. There's the snared one. Yeah, the snared one is actually still at the waterhole there. Let's just wait here and see if they come past us. I don't know if you noticed the way they walked down the hill there. She walked down with a very kind of, it looks like what we call a must bull swagger. And it's just kind of a warning to animals around them that they're moving now and, you know, just kind of stay out the way. They open the ears and they move their shoulders from side to side like you saw there. Hello, Hannah. You're 9 years old and you live in South Africa. It's wonderful to hear your voice here from home. You say, how much can an elephant drink in one day? Well, they reckon a big bull elephant can drink about 100 litres of water a day. Now, 100 litres of water, Hannah, if you're 9 years old, you've done probably a little bit of that in your science classes at home, a bit of volume. But basically, that's 100 milk bottles in a day. If you can think of a milk bottle or a milk carton, thinking of drinking 100 of those in one day. That's what a big bull elephant will drink, especially in the height of the summertime. Now, these chaps are coming closer to us. We're just going to sit right here and see what happens. Well, they could choose to go around us, but they seem to be choosing to come closer. And you can see now from the dam cam that Jerry's going to cut to where we're sitting in relation to the elephants. Now, I don't know that they're going to make it round to where they're going. I'm not sure that there's a space for them to get up the dam wall, but elephants are much more agile than we think they are. So I'm going to ask you to just keep watching on the dam cam. I don't really want to move just yet. And they, because you can see them going up the hill. If I start the engine, I don't want to give them a fright. What I'll do is just reverse slightly. They stop to feed on the wall now, Jerry says. I'm going to reverse a little. Just don't want to make them afraid, because they've been so confiding with us. So while you watch them, I'll just move so that I can see them again. Rather wonderful that we have this view of them. You've got them there. There we are. We can just see the matriarch there. Amazing. Walking up onto the dam wall. Now, your view of them, I'm sure, was pretty impressive, but you can see how these animals are anything but unagile. And there we've got a view of them. And she's just making sure that everybody comes up after her. Now, in a herd like this, it's obvious to tell that that's the matriarch. She's the biggest cow by some margin. She's obviously older than the rest of them. And it's also obvious that she's leading them. And I think the half-trunk one should be coming up the hill now. Here he comes. Hello, Richard. A very good question from you in Canada. You say, is there a name for an animal that browses and grazes, or is it just called a herbivore? No, it's called a mixed feeder. It's not a particularly imaginative name, Richard, but and probably therefore quite easy to remember. That's how I remember it. It's a mixed feeder. So a herbivorous mixed feeder would be an animal that eats both browse and graze. But of course, with elephants, they will eat more than that. They'll eat fruit and they will eat bark. Very few other animals will eat bark. They'll eat pods. I wonder if that elephant we saw earlier wasn't a little bit sick, because this matriarch looks to be in pretty good nick in comparison with her. So I wonder if she didn't perhaps have some kind of disease. You can see the hips on this matriarch much less defined, much less obviously prominent. And the little one just staying close to Mum. Maybe thinking about having something to drink, because that trunk ain't quite feeding it yet. Trying bits and pieces. There we go, trunk's starting to function properly now. Mary, you've obviously been thinking about the lions, perhaps. You say elephants suckle communally in the same way, I'm guessing, as you've seen lions doing. They don't by default, but they will if they have to. So were that little elephant that you're seeing walking down the hill there in a slightly awkward fashion, were that elephant to become orphaned, then yes, some other cow would probably adopt him. I mean, this herd would be a bit difficult, given that there seems to be only one big adult in it. But yes, they will do that. But they won't within a herd, if there are a number of lactating females, they won't by default cross-suckle. I imagine it happens, though, you know. I imagine were a hungry calf to go towards a matriarch or a female that had milk or was lactating and wasn't necessarily her mother, I imagine that in some cases she would be tolerant of that and allow the calf to suckle. Let's just wait to see what she does there. I think she's going to make her way down, and then we'll make our way towards Beefle's Hook Dam. Hello, George. Look at that. Isn't that amazing? As you see that swelling on her, underneath her hip there, and on the right-hand side. George, you say, how do you tell if an elephant's pregnant? It's normally a swelling, sorry, not behind, just in front of the hip and slightly below it is where you will see the swelling of a potential fetus. So that's basically how you do it, George. I have been mistaken before, though. In fact, I once had an elephant like that, and I was in Zambia around Livingstone and with some friends there, and I was the only supposed bush person. I said, well, you can see that cow's pregnant, of course, with which the male elephant went to the loo and revealed immediately through the medium of his fifth leg that he wasn't in fact pregnant at all, but a young bull. On that note, let's go across to Brent and get an update from him.
So we've left the area where we think the lions are. Well, I'm pretty sure there's some lions there. So what looks like happened is the females have left by themselves in one of those little ravines. And I'm not going to go walk in and scare the poor little cubbies. The females have spread out hunting. We've got single tracks going all over the place. So I'm hoping later on the sunset safari, as it gets a bit cooler and they start moving, we're probably going to have a bit more luck. So in the meantime, I'm going to head down towards Cheetah Plains. I feel like I haven't been there in an age. Just to go see what's going on there and look for Inkanin or Quarantine, Cheetah, or maybe even the Styx Pride. And the Styx Pride we're seeing north of there yesterday, so who knows, maybe they've crossed south onto Cheetah Plains. But before I do that, I'm having a sneaky little squiz around some of Karuda's favorite areas for leaving cubs. If she's out hunting and she's walked all the way through into Torchwood, I think maybe she left her cubs in one of her favorite spots along here, all in the Moati itself. So I'm just having a few quick squizzes in some of the favorite nursery spots for the Karula's cubs. But we have literally seen a couple of impala and that's it. We have not seen another animal yet. And I think this wind is keeping some of these animals battered down in the middle of these thickets and riverine areas. So I'm going to do a little loop into a riverine area to have a quick look, see if there's anything down in the Moati riverbed. we think about what we're going to, where we're going to explore next. Let's see how everyone's doing this morning or this evening, depending where you are in the world, with a quick tree quiz. Not the nearly impossible tree quiz, but a good one to start. Now, this particular individual's been pulled down by elephants a little bit. Let's get a branch. There we go. So I'm gonna go back, there we go. The leaves are quite distinct, quite crinkly as well. Quite distinct, quite crinkly. This is a particularly difficult individual of these trees. They do have quite a lot of different forms, depending where they've been fed on by elephants, depending where they're growing. But I think there's another one up ahead, so we'll show you this one again off to my right. What tree is that? If you know the answer, pop me an email, questions@wildearth.tv, or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. I will try to show you another example of that tree shortly. I think it's good, actually, no, maybe let's leave it at that. Let's leave it a little bit tough, because it's not the hardest tree to identify. Okay, so I'm gonna head down now into the Mawati River. See if we find any tracks, or even better, any cats. Okay, so river is a strong word for the Mawati. A better description would probably be a dry creek bed. But it is a favorite for leopards in particular, and all sorts of other creatures. And this little section here, we found Karula's cubs in a couple of times where she's left them while she's gone hunting. So worth having a quick look. We get to pass under some of these glorious African ebony trees. Give us a little respite from the sun. Hi, Monty in Virginia. Monty's wondering, do these little rivers ever get full of water? They can do, they can flash flood, Monty, but they subside very quickly. It's very uncommon that they flow for more than a day or two. Normally, even if they fly so high we can't cross them, it'll be for a matter of hours before they drop. Okay, so, no such luck yet. No tracks either, but they could be sitting up on the drainage line in the thickets. It's a great place for leopards. Great place to store your cubs. Lots of nice trees for them to be able to climb. Good afternoon, Juan Pierre. He says, is this a blueberry tree? It's definitely not, but it shares a name with a common fruit you get outside of Africa, and some of it's actually grown in Africa, but it does share, one of its names does share with a common fruit. Okay, we've checked down to our, oh, what's that? I put my binoculars. Stump. Okay, so we're on our southern boundary now. There Hi, Hannah. Hannah's 9 years old and from South Africa. Is it a round-leaf teak? It's not, Hannah, but I will try to find you a round-leaf teak so I can show you why it's not. And in this part of South Africa, round-leaf teaks stay very, very small because they're one of the elephants' favorite foods. The elephants never let them get big. But I'll definitely try to spot you a round-leaf teak, Hannah, so I can show you. So the Game Drive Radio is just getting going. Everyone's getting out, listening to the updates. Not really anything to work off yet. And we've got a few more answers. And well done to Diane. It is indeed an apple leaf or a rain tree. And I'll tell you a bit more about it a little later because James has got an animal with a heartbeat.
Now, we have got some kudu here, everybody, and they're being relatively confiding for kudu. I'm going to depress the clutch, hoping to roll forward, but that's not happened, so we're just going to ease forward. Just over the top here, hope there's no squeaking of brakes. Get a nice view of these kudus. A whole lot of cows and the bull, young bull, whose mummy will no doubt be a hill. There's another bull, also very young. Let me just get into this position here. They're wondering why on earth we're moving so slowly about them. I'm still attempting to take a photograph of them. But the world's slowest animal photographer is struggling. Yep, not one so far. Just walking under that green tree that you had, there was an apple leaf like the one Brent was talking to you about. These subtle colours at the moment, you'll notice greys and browns and one or two bits of copper and bronze. And if you're lucky, you find an apple leaf tree and you find some green. Let us sneak forward again. This is how you have to sort of gain the trust of animals like kudu. You've got to move around in a way that almost makes you go to sleep because it's so slow. Well, here we go, Brian. I'm going to get this shot of her with the green in the background. Wonderful. Yes, it'll be blurred, but I'm going to get it.
At least try to get the tree shot.
Yes. The tree or the kudu?
The tree.
Not the kudu?
No.
Oh. All right. I'm going to disagree with you there. But now, of course, the kudu won't look at us. Brian said, everybody, that I need to get the tree in focus, not the kudu. I've disagreed with him. I think I got the kudu. Now she's going to move off, of course. Gosh, it's not easy, you know. She also doesn't want to be on camera. Come on, Mrs. Kudu. Look this way. That's it. She's got an itchy bottom, Brian. I think she sat on a thorn earlier. There we go. Oh, she's going to yawn. Rank average, everyone. Rank average, I have to tell you. I'm not even going to show it to you. Right, I think that's enough of this kudu sighting, don't you, Brian? Yes, let us press on. We still haven't reached Biffleshook Dam, where the great herds of antelope are going to greet us. Possibly vast swathes of buffalo wallowing in the mud, fighting off the elephants. or just some Egyptian geese shouting at each other incessantly. Okay, we're going to turn north now, up Nyala Road North. Sometimes people like to know the names of these roads, and it does get a little bit dodgy for signal sometimes in here, so if there's a bit of breakup, I apologize for that, but we'll be fine once we get out the other side. Last bits of greenery here on our right-hand side, Gymnosporia senegalensis, the red spike thorn trees, a couple of gwari trees, none of them really edible in any meaningful way to the browsers out here. And we're still, remember, not quite sure where that one Nkuhuma lioness has taken her little cubs. Hyena tracks. And, oh, sorry. What did she say, Brian?
Comms test.
Comms test. Got you, Jerry. Go again. Sorry. Pulled out my wire. Ah, Cheryl, nice one from you. What animal has the largest population number? You'd probably be quite surprised to know that I think it's most likely Macrotermes natalensis, which of course is the fungus-growing termite that grows those mounds. And in fact, there may be some species of ants that are even more numerous than that, but I'm going to go with Macrotermes natalensis. That is an animal, of course, but I mean, normally when we refer to animals, we often mean mammal, don't we? So the most numerous mammal in this area, other than the human being, would be an impala. They are by far the most numerous mammals that we have on the reserve. Just making sure these are hyenas and not wild dogs. No, they are hyena tracks. Not very distinct, so I'm not going to try and stop and show them to you. And then, of course, if we are we're looking at sort of higher animals, if you like, so the vertebrates, I guess the most numerous vertebrate in this area, when they come through here, would be the red-billed quillas, which are probably the most numerous bird in the whole world. And so when they come flocking through here, they will come through sometimes in millions, and that makes them immediately the most numerous vertebrate in the area. A vertebrate being something with an endoskeleton or an internal skeleton like us, unlike a termite. I'm astounded we still have signal. That's great news indeed. Not even any breakup at all. Connor is going to pat himself soundly on the back for this effort. There's a Nyala. Two of them. Three. Four. Five. Six. Now, everybody, this is the very first time I've ever managed to have a sighting here. It's always been black screen here before. Beautiful Nyala. And of course, so it was quite a good place to have a rest if you wanted to have a rest on drive. So we're not going to be able to do that anymore, are we, Brian? No. Let me take another rank average photograph. Yes, as Jerry says, very funny, Jerry. Ha ha ha. Nyala Road with Nyalas, indeed. Well done, Jerry. Bit of signal breakup there. He's a magnificent bull, that chap, isn't he? I wish he'd look here so that I can take his portrait, but he won't. Now he's put his head down behind a tree. Very irksome of him. so slow and sedate, these fellows. They never seem to be in too much of a rush. Well, unless they're being chased by wild dogs. Then they look quite rushed, don't they, Brian?
Exceptionally.
Yes. The light is just starting to soften, everyone. You can see that it was pretty harsh to start with. And now as we head towards the latter parts of the afternoon, it's just starting to soften a bit, which makes that backlit impala look rather pretty. Of course, none of them will look at the camera. These photographs, I'm almost certain, will be destroyed as soon as I put them on my machine. And look at the grass just behind them. If we look up at the termite mound just behind there, you can see that lovely grass just glowing there. That's that, I think it's that Chlorus, that feathered Chlorus, Chlorus roxburghiana. Indeed, it would seem to be that. Growing on the termite mound there. This is a very peaceful little scene, everybody, especially with the gentle northwest wind blowing. And not a bird in earshot. Not one. This is very strange. There's the bull. Now, Hugh, of course, is looking after them. Well, he doesn't look after them. He dominates this harem, so most of these will be his offspring. But that's not a fixed kind of arrangement, so he will move off to other bulls at various times. It's quite possible that one of these cows is an estrus, and that's why he's with them. But it's not a sort of stable arrangement like a zebra herd, where the stallion is, he's always with the same herd. You get a sense of the peace of this area now. A complete lack of sound. Right, I think we shall move on now, Brian, don't you? Shall we go and see what is at the dam? Right, on we go. It is so peaceful. That is why I'm speaking in such a peaceful voice, Brian. Thank you so much. Yes. Hello, Monique in London, you say that you are always fascinated by the fluffy tails of the Nyala, but they seem so almost incongruous. They are. The other ones that do, but most of the tragulaphid species, the spiral-horned antelope, have got fluffy tails. The kudu also have got quite fluffy tails, and the bushbuck likewise. I'm not sure why. I mean, well, they're fluffy and white underneath because they flick them up when they're running, and that helps them to follow each other through the thick bush. So perhaps that's why they're fluffy. But they are definitely fluffier than the impalas, for example. All right, Brent Smith has managed to make it all the way across to Cheetah Plains, and Rusty, let's go and find out what his discoveries are.
So we've had some discoveries. Unfortunately, the Styx Pride on a kill not too far from us, but unfortunately to the north of us. I'm not sure, it sounds like a buffalo. I'm not sure how big the buffalo is. But there's always still a chance of Mr. Q, one of our favorite leopards. Of course, Cheetah, or Nkanyin and her two cubs. And I'm hoping what I really feel like on this sunset safari is a nice big elephant bull that's come in from the crew, a nice big tusker. So I'm gonna check all the water holes first. Now We're about to approach three in a row pan. I'm really hoping there's a big elephant there. Hi Chitra. And Chitra's in India. And she says, with the onset of spring, is there going to be an increase in the bird population? Most definitely, Chitra. We're going to get our migrants back, but I think the migrants might be a little bit late this year because of the drought. And even with those summer migrants, it all depends on local rainfall, what area they come to. So it's never a sure thing, so to say. But there will definitely be a lot more birds. We should start seeing, the first will be probably the European swallows, maybe some carmine beaters, a little bit later the European beaters, the woodlands kingfishers. So fingers crossed, there'll be lots and lots and lots of birds. But there are definitely not lots and lots of elephants at the waterhole. It doesn't look like there have been, no, haven't been here today either. See the baby there? Look at that. A baby blacksmith lapwing. He's gonna hide there. I can hear the adults tinking away. That's the baby. Isn't that incredible? Now the adults are flying around making a lot of noise trying to distract us from where the baby is. That baby immediately scuttled into a protected area and nestled down. And you can see the camouflage of those little creatures is incredible. It's not going to be able to fly yet. I'm not going to stay too long because mom and dad get quite upset. But isn't that fun, that little baby blacksmith lapwing? So mom and dad are just over there. I said we're not going to stay too long. They get quite upset. So what, there we go, look at that. Yes, we're not gonna stress them out too much, we're gonna move on. Now, most of the lapwings have an incredible defense for their youngsters because their youngsters aren't able to fly for a while and they nest on the ground. So if we were on foot walking there, that the lapwing will actually run and pretend to have a broken wing in front of you to try lure you away from where the baby is. Very, very dry. No elephants here. Doesn't look like they've been here today either. Maybe they're all at the Cheetah Plains pan. So that was three in a row pan we've just passed. Big herd of buffalo through here last night by the looks of things. Maybe that's the same herd that the sticks managed to catch that buffalo out of. See, the Cheetah Plains area is slightly more arid than Juma. Even though we're not too far away, they've had less rain, so there's less grass, less leaves, and that's why the water holes in this area are so important for the animals, and always a good place to check for animals. We're going to keep moving towards the next waterhole. While we do that, James has got the tallest creature in the African bush.
The tallest creature next to, of course, Brian Joubert. Not so, Brian. Exactly. There's a giraffe, everybody, as identified by the fact that it is browsing. That's how you know it's a giraffe, don't you, Brian?
Yes.
The identifying feature, the fact that it's eating leaves and is relatively large. It is a bull giraffe. We know that from the balding horns. I too have balding horns. Brian, you do not have balding horns, do you?
I have lovely flowing luscious locks.
You are very lucky to have lovely flowing luscious locks. Them days is over in my case. This giraffe is now offended, of course, that we have described him as having balding horns. I was also offended, Mr. Giraffe, until I got used to the idea. He looks deeply surprised. I don't know why I find that amusing. He's quite amusing. Let me just go back a little bit more. And a bit more. It's almost like he's looking at me as if to say, yeah, who do you think you are? How dare you comment about my lack of hair? Well, my friend, that is the way of things. And you must get used to it. Because I have to say, Mr. Giraffe, once you accept and embrace your baldness, you will feel so much better about it, I promise. I speak the truth to you. There, you see, he's now starting to agree with me, Brian. You see that, how he's moved his ears. He's coming to a state of acceptance now.
I think you just shocked him.
I think I did, to start with. But I think now that he's over the shock of the realization that he's losing his hair, he's going to be okay. We could call him the Jason Statham of giraffes. But then we'd be going too far with the joke, wouldn't we? It would be rather ridiculous. Yes. He also has beautiful eyelashes, though, doesn't he, Brian? Yes. Very impressive eyelashes, my friend. He just looks so utterly astounded by our presence here. Come on. There we are. And again, just all around him, if Brian zooms out a little bit, you'll see the light shining through these tamburti trees. Now, the tamburti trees are quite evergreen, but probably semi-deciduous, which means they lose their leaves periodically, and then they come back again. And with the giraffe, one of the few animals that's able to eat the poisonous sap of the tamburti. Not many can do that. Very fine fellow indeed. We've yet to make it to Biffleswick Dam, everybody. We keep being stopped by these animals. Our species list today, of course, Brian, vast. Impala, nyala, kudu, giraffe, waterbuck, elephant.
Our cup doth overflow.
Our cup doth overflow. And crested bobbit. There he is. The classic giraffe tilt. Very nice, Brian.
Thank you.
Yes.
I do what I can.
You do. Very well. Let me go back slightly more, everybody. Oh, beautifully framed. Yes, no, that look is definitely one of disdain on his face, everyone. He's not even chewing the cud. He's looking behind us at something. I think it's just the swaying of the trees in this gentle breeze. And again, you cannot hear any kind of bird for some reason, and I just don't understand. I don't get why there aren't any birds calling this afternoon. There weren't any yesterday afternoon either, you know. Now he's heard something. Oh, very good idea. Patricia, you say maybe I can tell him what tree helps with baldness. Well, I can tell him for free that no tree helps with baldness, but I can tell him that apparently, Mr. Giraffe, apparently the Papia capensis or jacket plum tree does in fact help with baldness. So what you can do is you can take it, rub it on the top of your horns and see if the luscious locks of your youth don't return. I personally think you should just embrace it. Yes, he's very shocked. Okay, let's move on to Biffleshook Dam. We're not far from there. Good luck. That is the most bemused giraffe I've ever seen. Hello, Arba. You want to know if a giraffe has ever behaved in an aggressive fashion towards me? No. I have never seen a giraffe behave in an aggressive fashion towards a human being, and I have been within 1 meter at one stage. I lay on the ground and let one come and say hello to me, and it came to within a meter and was looking at us. So, no, I have never seen that. They will become aggressive if they are sufficiently threatened. So, with lions and with leopards, they will absolutely become quite nasty. They kick exceptionally well with both feet, front and back, and lions can often be killed when trying to hunt giraffe. If the giraffe aims a well-placed kick at a lion's head, the lion will often be killed. So that does happen if you threaten them sufficiently, but I've never threatened a giraffe to that point. That said, I do know of people who've been hurt by a giraffe inadvertently, especially at night. So they watch them being hunted by lions, and then the giraffe, of course, if you're shining a spotlight, becomes totally panicked. It can run at the car and won't see the car and it'll just run straight over it. Now that's a 1.5 ton animal in the case of a big giraffe. And so you can imagine 1.5 tons hitting a car like this. And because it's so gangly and long, it basically just folds over whatever it runs into. And so you can get yourself and your guests into quite a lot of trouble. So you do hear the odd story like that, but that's about the sort of level of damage and how damage is done by a giraffe if it happens. Right, we're arriving at the Great Waterhole. Hello, Brock. You want to know about the different kinds of giraffes that you find around Africa and how many kinds there are? Well, it's a bit of a moot point. Lots of people debating how many kinds of different giraffes we get, but I'll show you a picture of all of them. I think the general consensus at the moment is about 9. But it varies between 7 and 13. Now, while you are looking at Biffleshook Dam, I shall retrieve pictures of all these different kinds of giraffes, all of which are the same species, according to some. Some say they're different species. Gosh, I just find it rather confusing. The one that we get here, everybody, is called the southern giraffe. Let me just find them all for you. This book I've got is wonderful because it's got all the different pictures of the different kinds that we get. Luckily, nothing has fallen prey to the mud yet. Right, can you see that, Brian? Is that fine? Okay, so we get the reticulated giraffe. Well, they're all in Latin. It's going to be difficult to understand. That's the one we get. That's the southern giraffe. Then you get the reticulated giraffe, the Angolan giraffe, which should be Angolensis. It is Angolensis. I don't see Angolensis suddenly. Which isn't... Oh, there it is. That's the one down at the bottom of the page there. Angolensis, then the one up near sort of Tanzania and Kenya, which is the blue one, which is called Tipakuski. Basically, that's that one there. You can see that. I think that's also called the Maasai giraffe. And then you get the reticulated giraffe. That's also up in sort of East Africa. Yeah, and a light, morph reticulated giraffe. So lots of different kinds. They've got seven here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. They've got 8 in this particular example. Right. So those are the different kinds of giraffes. But like I say, some people say they're species, some people say they're subspecies, some people say that there are 13 of them. I don't think they really care. I think the point is that they can probably all interbreed. Maybe the West African ones will struggle to interbreed with the Southern and East African ones, but I think you'll find that they could probably hybridize very successfully, and there'd be no sort of lack of species integrity, if you like, through that. I think it's just a fact that they're different colours, different races from the different geographical positions in which they find themselves. Really not much going on here. Hello, Gracie. Thank you very much, you say. Old is beautiful. And in, what was it? Old is beautiful, and in boys it's cute. Is that correct, Gracie? Oh, and the bald is beautiful. Thank you very much, Gracie. I think you're absolutely bang on correct. Well done. Now, let's go back across to Brent Leo Smith and find out how he's going in the great plains of Cheetah.
So our tracking endeavours are not working in our favour today. We've just been tracking a male leopard. Quite nice tracks considering the time of the day and the amount of wind, but he has decided to go on holiday to the Kruger National Park. There's a nice clear track up ahead, so we'll show you that one. Now it could be quarantine, it could be Shivambalan. Those are the two male leopards that are seen most frequently in this area. It could be an unknown male from Kruger. There we go. You can see the tracks there in the road. Big male leopard track. Alas, he's gone on holiday. Well, even the leopards deserve a holiday. And that particular section of Kruger that's behind us here to the east is what we'd call a wilderness area. So there's only a few management roads, but there are no public tourist roads or anything in that area. So it is an area where the animals can go and they won't see any people, maybe the odd anti-poaching patrol. Now, update on those two cheetah, they also went on holiday to Kruger. Okay, now I am looking for two trees in particular. I'm looking for a different version of the wren tree to show you, and I'm looking for a round leaf teak tree, and hopefully I'll find those shortly. This is not the right place to look for them on the open plains, but we're going to scoot through the open plains and then head back down towards the west, and maybe we'll get lucky. Tundi, the female leopard, sometimes in the area, sometimes her unnamed daughter is also in that area. But that's the only tracks we've seen on Cheetah Plain so far, that male leopard on his way out to go on a holiday in the Kruger. Now we went past Cheetah Plains Power and I was really hoping for some elies, but alas, no elephants, so maybe we'll find them somewhere else. Okay, now we're right in this area between the two different open areas. So we've got nice big marulas around. We've got this broad-leafed woodland, mostly made up of red bush willows and variable bush willows. Oh, there we go. There's a... And because it's quite windy, it might work quite well today. So here we go, the seeds of the red bush willow. Now, let's just see if we can get the wind to line up with us. The wind is coming from the north. Let's ago. Now, I'm going to fix it shortly. Incredible design. Oh, of course, now the wind decides to die down. But you can see it's got four wings. Now, those wings are designed to catch wind. There we go, like that. Now, that one did it perfectly, so I'm going to put it there to catch the wind again. I'll put the bit further there, Vim. Okay, come on, wind. Give us a gust. Gust wind. Oh, you want to go? Let's just change the angle. Get the wings to catch the most wind possible. There we go. So that's how they spread. They're blown by the wind at this time of the year. That's why it's releasing seeds now at this time of the year when it's quite windy. And the wind will blow it and they'll roll. And that's how they spread and disperse their seed throughout the area. The other thing that, oh, hello, disperses seed for them is actually that brown-headed parrot is a great seed disperser of Bretum. Sorry, I just saw a track that I didn't notice. Oh, hello. This is a very nice track, considering the wind. It's a female leopard. Now, this is in Kanyeni's territory. And I haven't heard any of her tracks called in. It looks like she might have come straight out of the Kruger and in here. Now, I'm just going to have a quick look a little bit to each side, because she does have those young cubs. Young adults. They're around 9 months old now. So their footprint size will be very similar size to her. It's just one track. Now look at that, the bush willow has got us a lead, because I probably would have missed those while I was driving if it hadn't been for that bush willow. Very interesting. Well, we've got a lead, we've got something to follow, so let's get on it. What we're going to do is we're going to make sure we can zoop around the block and see if the tracks come out on the other side. Also, do you want to make sure she isn't hunting through this area. Now, a lot of female leopards really like areas like this. They've often got quite a lot of steenbok, which is a very small antelope, as well as duiker. So we're going to go on a big loop around here, and if we don't get any luck, then I'll go back to that last track and I'll take a walk through these thickets. Catcher is wondering, how do we recognize the different tree species? Is it their leaf shapes? Does they all look so similar to me? Well, it's not only their leaf shape, Catcher, it's their general shape. So, and bark and where they grow are all really good indicators. And of course, the leaves as well. Always checking on the termite mounds. We all know leopards love a termite mound. But so far, no tracks coming out. Now this is the next big area for us to check very carefully. Make sure they don't pop across here. Hi, Megan in Texas. Megan says she's a safari addict. But this is her first time asking questions. Well, welcome to the question fray, Megan. Megan would like to know if we've got any updates on Sindile. Megan, at the moment, I haven't heard about Sindile for a while. Sorry, it's just a funny track, just the angle on hard ground, and it's a small hyena. But Megan, the last I heard, he was in the Manuleti, so I'm not 100% sure. I haven't heard any updates from him for quite a while. Okay, come on, little leopard, where are you hiding? So in this part of Africa, leopards will generally, you'll only really see them crossing big open areas like this. They don't tend to hunt too often on them. Not enough cover for them. But animal behavior throughout Africa is completely different. So a leopard in the Serengeti or Masai Mara has to hunt in the grassy areas because that's where the prey species are. What did you see? Vem has spotted our good mate Gnorman. The Gnormless Gnu. The victor. The wildebeest champion of the southern plains of Cheetah Plains. And of course, on the other plains, a little bit further to the north, is where Normal Norman, his nemesis, lives. And he's got an oxpecker. Sorry, Vim, just go a little bit to the right. Did I see an impala there? It was just a bush. I was just trying to check so to know if to listen for alarm calls. Oh, on the ground, he's taken off. A lilac-breasted roller. Nice camera work, Vim. Doop. I'm just going to keep going along here, making sure her tracks don't come up. The one reason that might draw her out into the open is this little bit of water that's been left from that rain we had about 10 days ago. What's that in the distance? Straight ahead of us, then, on the road. I think it's impala. Nice herd of impala there. So I know we've got some watchdogs on the corner. And we'll alarm at any cat that's near them. While we keep looking for this leopard, let's go see how James is faring back on Juma.
Sorry about that, everybody. I was overwhelmed with shyness suddenly as we came live and I had to prepare myself. Then I hit that tree. It was very scary, wasn't it, Brian? Terrifying. Right, now, we are on the far northeastern corner of Juma. We are going south down the Cheetah Cut Line and there are some waterbuck. We've seen the male and now, Brian, the female and the babies. So amazing, is it not? They too are slightly astounded by us. And one a little male and one a little female there. You can see they've both got little horns. No, only the one. Beautiful. Look how furry they are. I've always thought it must be good to be a water buck in the winter. It must be a bit warmer. You just move a little bit closer. There we go. Now, There's an ideal opportunity here to observe the white marking on the buttocks, which is supposed to be some kind of a following mechanism. I'm not convinced that that's what it is. Of course, many other antelope, of course, follow each other very successfully without having white markings on their bottoms. I'm not sure why it would be like that. Isn't that nice? I think that's beautiful. Look at the grey colour there, they're moving through the bush. Perfectly, perfectly camouflaged for the winter. Not so much for the summer, but then they hide. If we were looking at this in summer, everyone, you wouldn't see those animals. They'd be hidden by leaves and thick bush. So in the winter, the perfect colour for camouflage. And we're often asked, what should we wear on safari? What should we bring on safari? And of course, I mean, if you can get a colour as close to a waterbuck's coloration as possible, that's probably the most easy way you will stay camouflaged. Not really that you need to be camouflaged if you're on safari, but if you do want to be camouflaged, that's a good colour to be. Not so, Brian. Yes. Ah, Brent has managed to find not quite the leopard for which he is still searching, but something much larger.
So, we've just been checking around the area to make sure those leopard tracks didn't come out. We've come across a very small little group of elephants. There's one young bull, this big female, and her calf that are coming towards us. And they're just heading back towards the Kruger, actually back towards where those leopard tracks were. So if we hear them trumpeting just now, we'll know that they might have spotted that leopard. Hello, naughty boy. What do you want, mister? Lovely little young boy. Hello. What do you want, Tara? Are you going to misbehave yourself? Hey. I'm watching you. Why are you sniffing my tire? I'll sniff you too. Yes, you're very scary. Just coming to give us a little sniff. He was actually sniffing the tire. Moving on. Can't hear any or see any others. I'm Monique in London. Monique's wondering, why are elephants digestive systems so ineffectual? Surely they should have evolved to be able to take more nutrients. Well, Monique, they are one of the keystone species. So if their digestive process was more effective, they wouldn't push around and break up as much as bush. They wouldn't defecate as much, and their defecation is home to fungus species. The Franklin and squirrels dig around in it, and by them pushing and pulling over trees, they create homes for whole other animals. So you probably find it's due to the fact that if they were more effective, they would have less effect on the ecosystem, and their effect on the ecosystem is a very important part of the ecosystem. So it's one of those really strange, incredible little miracles of nature, and everything is in balance. This is going to be a really tough year for the elephants. And they are feeding off lots of stuff they wouldn't choose to feed off in a normal year. But that's good for the bush. And some of those species might have been becoming a bit overpopulated with the 10 really wet years we had. So now in this incredibly dry year, the elephants are putting pressure on those species that might have been taking over a little bit from grass. So everything works out in the end, Monique. So it's an incredible, incredible interlinked system. So we're going to let those ellies continue on moving. We've got a little bit longer to check round before we go back to those female leopard tracks. Okay, so I haven't seen any tracks yet and I've been looking really carefully, so I'm quite confident she must still be in this block. And fortunately for me, it's not too big a block. I'm just gonna go have a walk through there, but I just gotta be careful. Well, at least I know where the elephants are when I go walking, because there is a strong wind and you've just got to be a little bit more cautious when the winds are strong when you're walking in the bush. Okay, we're going to head back towards those female leopard tracks. I'm going to take a quick stroll. While we do that, let's go to James with a striped donkey.
There, everybody, is a striped donkey. You see that, Brian?
No, I do.
A donkey with stripes thereupon. A Birchall's zebra, everybody. And Judy H., who is a font of wonderful articles and things she sends me, sent me a sort of biography of William Birchall's. And Birchall, of course, was the man, the naturalist and polymath, as he was described, who gave the zebra his name, the Birchall zebra, Equus Birchelli. And that's him. William Birchall, unlike his cohort Wahlberg, did not die as a result of being attacked by a buffalo. He died at home, as far as I'm aware, in Fulham. Having collected over 63,000 species, one of which could well have been what you're going to see with Brent now.
So it's been so quiet, but all of a sudden we've had an elephant. Now we've found an incredible bird, not one we get to see too often, and a bird that favors the open plains. There it is, the secretary bird. An incredible bird of prey. Now, one of their favorite foods is snakes, and they've got those incredibly long legs that they use to kick snakes to death with. I don't want to get too close in case we spook it. The last secretary birds I actually saw in the exact same spot. Now, I'm keeping an eye out. They normally are in pairs. So there could be another one around. This one's coming towards us. That click click is just me getting a picture. It's not a bird we see too often. Go! The run-up. Strangely enough, the last time, Vim, was it with you that we saw them here? I think it was with Vim, and it did the same thing and landed on the top of the same tree. Except we had both of them on top of the same tree. I'm going to just stop so you guys can get some silhouetted screenshots before trying to get a bit closer in case it flies on. Where's the second one? Oh, I'm just keeping my eyes open. Oh, 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 balancing. Don't fall. Now, what might happen is you watch, there we go, it's doing exactly what I was hoping. So that secretary bird's actually found a spot. That's where it's gonna roost for the evening. So I'm not gonna go any closer, because it's found such a good spot to roost, And I've actually seen two secretary birds on top of that exact milkberry. So I wonder if that secretary bird's partner will come and join. Now, they mate for life. And they are a funny looking bird. Now, it's the tall up again. Well, it seems like a lot of you are very happy to see a secretary bird. It is not something we see often. As I was saying, that they mate for life normally. Oh, there you are, just trying to get comfortable atop the milkberry. Just scanning very carefully to see if the other one's around. It's unusual to only have one. So I've been just checking all around here, maybe behind us, but it doesn't look like it. And I said, I don't want to go any closer. I don't want to disturb it if that's where it's going to roost for the evening. I'm going to go a bit further forward though. We might spot the other one. Now they favour the short grass plains. Now Alice in Ohio is saying, how big is that bird? It looks huge. It is, it's about 1.4 metres tall. It's not that heavy though, it weighs about 4 kilograms. So like most birds, quite slightly built. Just trying to see if we can see another one. I can't, because I don't want to get too close to that one. Might disturb it from its roosting spot. And while we were looking at that, I just suddenly heard those elephants give a very aggressive trumpet. So I'm wondering if they bumped into that leopard. So from a very quiet little period, we're going into quite a busy period. Now let's just hope the elephants didn't chase the leopard into Kruger again. Hi Karen, the Zimbo in London is asking, do we get the grey-crested crane in the Sabi Sands? I've never seen them here. We used to get them on our family farm in the KwaZulu-Natal, and also you do get them right up in the north of Kruger in the Pofuri region, but not down here. Okay, so this is where those female leopard tracks disappeared, and off, she marched off that way. And the elephants trumpeted a bit further away. So now I'm trying to think. What do you think, Liam? Should we go for a walk or should we do one little more loop up ahead? Let's check it out. Let's go a bit further forward. I agree. Then if we can spot the elephants through the bush here, we'll have a good idea about where they're trumpeting and where to go look next. Elephants were about here, I reckon, coming through this sort of direction. Is that an elephant there? So that marula is a big one. I'm trying to see, is that an alley next to it? No, it's a termite. Now, what you can do in situations like this is use the lay of the land. So that's exactly what I'm going to do. Very quickly, I'm going to use the lay of the land to see if I can spot those elephants. Vim, how's my audio? Okay, so even though I can't see the elephants, I can see where they're feeding and there's dust coming up. They're still coming this way. There's a big path that comes through here. And we can see they haven't crossed on top of our tracks yet. But I think they're actually coming this way. So they likely encountered that leopard in that section. So I'm gonna go back to where I had her tracks and I'm gonna go take a walk. So quite often with animals like elephants and buffalo in certain circumstances, even if you can't see them, you can see that they're there. So what I was looking for there, if I couldn't actually see the elephants, I was looking for trees possibly moving, but they gave themselves away by creating a lot of dust, kicking up dust. Now, I was atop a very big termite mound there, and Janet was asking, do the termite mounds extend down into the ground or they're only above the ground? Janet, they're like an iceberg, so there's more of it under the ground than there is above. Those eddies were just in here somewhere. And that leopard track was there. So I'm hoping that that leopard's in this little triangle here. There is a possibility it could be a female leopard we don't know from Kruger, and she might be quite skittish. So I'm going to go quite slowly, and I'm going to get back to the last track and go have a little walk into the bush. Okay. That is that little area where I think this female leopard is. I've got back to the last tracks. I'm just going to listen for a few seconds, see if the elephants do anything. Can't hear anything at the moment, so I'm going to go check on foot. While I do that, let's go see what James is up to.
We're up to two things, everybody. The first thing is that I've just seen a brown-hooded kingfisher fly into this thicket, but I think we won't see it. I'm sure it's come out of a nest here. It's probably a nest here, but the main thing is that I've heard the grey go-away birds going, I think from the top of the jackalberry tree that we've been looking at for some time now, because it's fruiting, and I'm just wondering if there isn't a leopard around here somewhere. Because that they do that when they're upset, when they're alarm calling at something. So it's possible. Hold your thumbs, Brian. Well done. Holding the cucumber. Is it cool on the palm? Just look around here. Now, I mean, we're in the vicinity that if Karula does cross back north, this is the area into which she could cross. I don't see any tracks. Let's go out of the drainage. Again, kudos to Connor. We've got signal here at Wendy, which is not normal. This is the fruiting tree in which I suspect the birds were sitting. We'll just do a loop around the dam, then we'll go back into the drainage, I think. It would be so very nice to see a cat today. We've been so cat-spoiled of late, I feel, that we're probably not quite appreciative of them when we do see them. Because we tend to find them now, especially now that they've all got cubs, around just about every corner. Not today. No, nothing over here. We'll drive a little bit quicker onto the dam wall, which will afford us a view to the north and to the west. There we go, to the north, everyone. I'm going to stop here and let's see if we can hear them again. I think I can see a grey go-away bird quite far away there beyond the jackalberry tree. Yep, that's him there. Okay, let's go that way. Kimberly, you want to know why we drive around the corner there. How do we know one track from the next? How do you know whether they're fresh or not? You need experience, basically. There's some obvious tips you can use. So, for example, if you see a lion track in the early morning and you want to know if it was from last night or recently, you'll check, are there civet tracks nearby, and are civets or white-tailed mongoose or genets, which are nocturnal animals, have they walked on top of the track or not? That obviously gives it away. Or is there a dove track on it? We know that doves are diurnal and they only come down onto the ground at the very early morning, so are there dove tracks on top of it, or is he perhaps walking on top of doves? So those are some obvious ways. Then the distinction of the track. So are they distinct in whatever substrate you happen to be looking at them? So if you're on sand like this, are they still distinct or have they lost some of their definition? That would be a good way of aging them. But really, it does largely depend on your experience and especially within a particular area. I still struggle to know if something's particularly fresh or not particularly fresh, depending on where the animals walked. Now, if you're on a fairly clay-rich soil, so something that holds a mould, if you like, then the chances are it's a bit easier. You can see whether the tracks are more fresh or not because they hold their shape and then they lose their shape when there's wind. On sand, it's very difficult to tell if a track is fresh or not because they lose this sort of definition. We're going to go back into the drainage and up the way. We might be lucky. Hold on, Brian. Put on your wetsuit. We're going into the water. Splish, splash. Somebody's going to come and take us away one day, Brian. James Duncan, yes, grey go-away birds will absolutely eat the jackalberry fruits. They will love the jackalberry fruits. Just about everything out here that eats fruit will eat jackalberry fruits, especially when they're ripe, and they've just started to ripen now. About a week ago I tried some, they were disgusting, to the point of being completely inedible to me, but now they seem to be ripening, and I gave some to Connor today. He wasn't that impressed, but they are quite nice. I didn't eat it myself because I'd watched a monkey spit it out. I don't think he saw that though. That might have been why it didn't taste so good, do you think, Brian? Most likely, hey. I saw this thing, dropped it on the ground, and I picked it up and it was still wet from where obviously the monkey had been sucking it. So I peeled the skin off and I handed Connor a piece of the fruit, and I was about to eat some myself, and I thought, nah, I'll do it next time. Yeah, it was around here, I think, that the birds were calling. Now, Karula does like to cross this drainage, and it's interesting. I've watched... it seems relatively few, but I've watched leopards move around. Oh, there's an owl that I missed because I was waffling away. Can you see it? Is it a pearl-spotted owl? It looked a little large. Might be a barred owl. Oh, there it is. It is a pearl-spotted. Can you see it there? You see the thickish branch on the knobthorn? As it bends down, it's just behind there. Well, if you zoom in to where you are there... Yeah. To the right a little. I think it is. What I'm going to do, everybody, is try and call it. Just see the shape of it there, everyone. It might be a barred owl, but I don't think it is. Whatever it is completely unconvinced that I am a pearl-spotted owl. Let me look now. I think I can see. You got it there. Sorry, everyone. We will just quickly try and see if we can't see him. Can you see the oriole? Okay, let me move forward slightly. There's also a grey go-away bird. There's the oriole. Oh, that's a nice shot if you can get him. Can you get him there? Well done. Brilliant. Now, I have been waiting for some time to get a black-headed oriole on camera. I have failed to do it, and there you are. Isn't that nice? The colours are just too spectacular. Let me just try something here. I may be calling the wrong bird. I could hardly see it in there. What I'm going to do is call the barred owl and see if that one doesn't talk. But I think it's a pearl-spotted who just doesn't understand my speaking of its language. That's the barred owl, everyone. There. It is a barred owl. Listen. How cool is that? That's not me, everyone. That's the bird. So it was a barred owl. Isn't that great? Now, can you hear that clicking sound? Can you hear that click, 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 click? It sounds like alarming to me. I'm going to reverse slightly. Let's just see behind us if there isn't a leopard. James Richard, while we see what these helmet shrikes, I think they are. No, it's not helmet shrikes. James Richard, I'm going to answer your question while I just stick my head up over the top here. Ryan, you'll tell me if we lose sound, will you? You want to know, is there any obvious difference between a crepuscular owl and a nocturnal one? The answer is no, not really. I'm going to whisper a little bit now, just in case there's something lying in here. There's a diker. These are chin spot battuses, everybody, that you can hear going click, 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 click. But I don't think they'd have been alarming at the diker. I've seen Karula right here before. I've seen Mvula here before. James Richard, there are no differences, no, not obvious ones. And that's because the crepuscular ones do, of course, tend towards nocturnal activity. So things like the barred owl and the pearl-spotted owl do absolutely tend towards nocturnal behavior. Do I need to walk backwards, Brian?
You're still good.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
You can still hear me.
Okay.
Amazing. So, no, they're all kind of drab. None of them are particularly bright colors. I think you'll find if there were any truly diurnal ones, then they probably would be fairly bright colors. There's something going on here. I don't know what it is. There was a diker there, though, and I can hear some elephants. I therefore suspect that there aren't any leopards here. Let's go forward. We might see the elephants. It would be quite nice. It would be very nice, wouldn't it, Brian?
Would be.
Okay, let me just put this back. Now, just to reiterate, everyone, I don't really like to call the birds with my bird app. I will do it. If I'm unable to do it myself, and just to re-identify that bird. I don't think we did him any harm, but I think if you repeat doing it, it obviously confuses them because they think there's a bird in their territories and they get... What? The owl? Brian's got the owl, everyone. No? Say when? Oh, well spotted. Is it there? There is the African barred owlet, everybody. Unfortunately, just behind a little piece of bushel. Shall I move back a bit, Brian? Forward. How's that? There we go. Isn't that beautiful, everyone? Look at that. That is fantastic. I can't even see him with my naked eye. How beautiful is that? Right out in the open. Huh? Jerry, go again? Right, there's a female lion at the Juma Dam Pan. Okay, I think we'll probably have to go there because, of course, the barred owl... well, we've had a good sighting, haven't we, Brian?
We have.
Should we go and see the lion?
Let's go see the
lion. I think we should go and see the lion because she could well be with some cubbies. Brilliant. That was a wonderful sighting. Okay, we're going to go and see if we can find that lion. I'm going to call him in just to check... And let's go and have a look. I will just quickly show you what's at the dam cam. Go for it, Geraldine. Stations, apparently there's a lioness drinking at Juma Pan. I'm going there now, but please make your way there if you're close. I'm about 5 minutes out. There you are, everyone.
Okay, thank
you. You can see it. And she's now heading down towards the dam. And I'm just going to keep everybody on the game drive informed. Stations, that animal is now mobile into the dam. We're watching it from the camera, so I'm not there yet. I'm on Twin Dams. Right, let's see if we can get there quickly, everyone.
Yeah, I'm on there.
There are the elephants. Cubby, station, if you can just keep a space for me there so I can move in when I get there. Negative, lioness. the elephants. I'm not sure which picture. Don't think, or do you? Dodgy signal. We're going to leave these elephants, little herd of elephants here. All right, she's just crossed the dam already. We're getting there as soon as I can. I think there are a few guys who are probably there or closer, and they'll get there and stay with her because the camera won't be able to stay with her forever.
Yeah, well, it depends who's getting there first. I don't know. No one there. I just saw the camera. I'm on Darika Khan.
We're probably about 5 minutes out, so just hold on. Don't be sick. And by that I mean, of course, we are going to shake you around a bit. And Jerry is still looking at the dam cam. You're still looking at the dam cam, so you can still see the lion. Well done, Zumi. We're hairing up there as fast as we can. You're still there, Brian? Good, good, excellent. And you're apparently now losing sight. All right, while we get there, Mr. Brent, get an update from him, and hopefully I'll have a lion when you next see me.
How exciting! One of the Nkuhumas must have popped out at the Juma Cam. I know James is racing there. Unfortunately, when I went walking into that block, there were a few more elephants than the original three we saw. So unfortunately, and the strong wind, it became a little bit unsafe. So we had to leave those leopard tracks. And we are on our way heading back towards the west at the moment. And I'd actually just said to him, I said, well, we should get back to Juma for the last hour because one of those lions is bound to pop out. And luckily she has. Now, there has been a report of Tandi as well in Chitwa Chitwa. But if she does move a little bit further to the west, maybe we can catch her on Gowrie Main on the way home. So fingers crossed. Hi, Julia in Houston. Julia, I said, did we ever confirm who that female leopard was we saw the other day? We did, Julia. Her name is Inchila, which means tail. She's got a very long, fluffy tail, and she is Insela's daughter from her last litter, and she is Salahesh's granddaughter. She, unfortunately, after visiting us very briefly, basically walked all the way back to Sibambili during the day between drives. So I was hoping we might find a kitty cat on Cheetah Plains, but alas, it seems they're on Juma at the moment. And the sticks, of course, are not too far away from us on a buffalo kill. Now, excuse me for a second. I'm just gonna pop my jersey on, it's getting a little bit nippy. There we go, at least I didn't have an accident. Now, of course, you never know what might pop around in the next corner, so we might have animals shortly. There's one last waterhole on Cheetah Plains we haven't checked. So let's go have a look. So there's one last waterhole, as I was saying. It's the one in front of the Cheetah Plains Lodge. And I have found the sticks there quite a few times, although we do know where they are. But maybe there's going to be a leopard or a Birmingham boy. Although at the moment, I might even take an impala. See anything at the waterhole. Vim, can you see anything? I see an animal, Vim. It's not a cat, but it is one of my favorites. With a lovely backlighting as well. Out of all the antelope we get here in the Sabi Sands. No, don't run away, big boy. There's a few of them. Oh, there we go. Oh, off they go. It's my favorite antelope in the Sabi Sands, the bushbuck. I find them absolutely stunning. There's a little female. And a little one. There was two males and a little female there. Two females, right? You probably find they're very relaxed around the vehicles. I mean, around the lodge and people, but not so much around the vehicles. They're probably just sneaking out of that little river system to go have a drink. Okay. Okay, well, we have driven nearly every road and covered every inch of Cheetah Plains. And I've still got the suspicion that more lions are going to pop up on Juma. So I'm going to start slowly making my way back towards Juma. Still haven't managed. I know exactly where there's round leaf teak on Juma, but I haven't seen any on Cheetah Plains today. This is my favorite time of the day as the sun starts to set. Well, actually, this and sunrise or first light, predators are going to start moving. There's always a chance of seeing a crepuscular animal. Apart from owls and nightjars, what other birds might we find or hear at night? Well, you'll hear thickneys. I'll show you what they look like, Chili. So you can hear thick knees, coursers as well, also another nocturnal bird species. We have seen that bronze-winged courser and Temex courser on the live drives in the last little while. Thick knees is probably the most common one. Okay, so now you might see these on the Juma Dam cam quite often as well, the water thick knee. Let me just get my finger in there to get that call on. There we go. So that's another bird you might hear at night, the water thick knee. And also the spotted thick knee, but they're not so dependent on water. Very similar, slightly deeper. And then my favorite of outside of the owls and nightjars of the nocturnal birds is of course is the coursers. There we go. So the most common one in this part of the world is the bronze-winged courser. We have seen them on the live drives before. Very distinct sound. And then we've only ever seen the Temex courser once, and that was on the open areas of Cheetah Plains. It is the smallest of all the African coursers. Another very distinct call. Now, the bronze-winged courser we'll find in this mixed woodland, whereas the Temex courser prefers short open plains. The spotted thick knee, again, also in the broadleaf woodland, and then the water thick knee anywhere around a little water hole. Okay, we're going to keep moving now west towards the setting sun. And while we do that, let's go see how James's search for the Incahomas is going.
Hello everyone, we're in the middle of the block here. At least you got to see the lion, we didn't get to see it though. This is where she was heading. We've got guys waiting the other side on the road, just not too far from here. That's the Gowri cut line. Well done to the zoomie for keeping an eye on her. I think we were probably 30 seconds too late. As we went in the direction that she came, and we have found nothing. I did hear a twig snapping over here. It's unlikely that she's made a twig snap, being a lioness. But I wonder. There are people sort of along the Gowri cut line over there waiting to see if she pops out. Maybe she's got cubs in that drainage system. That's certainly what Jamie and Brent thought after their morning tracking, at least their afternoon tracking yesterday. You right there? But they do know. We're just getting to that time of day when their colour is so completely perfect. I'm just listening to the radio. This, everybody, was where I had my first Incahoma pride sighting on my very first drive. And then the wild dogs came running through here. Just going to find out how many people are on Gowri cut line. There's a buffalo, two buffalo there. Stations, how many people on Gowri cut line at the moment?
Yeah, but we shall long way to finish up on
Confirm a vehicle or the animal?
The animal is crossing to the distance.
Tax and picked her up that way. She's crossed Gari cut line already, going into that rather heinous drainage line. So she's run. She's run through this block. We're not too far. Brian, if you show them, you see that big green tree over there? That's basically where she popped out, we think. And she's crossed the road now. Copy, Orbs, at least tax confirmed. No way you can get a car in there. We're not going to get a vehicle in there, everyone.
No, she's just crossing into the drainage line now. Okay.
We'll try and get there. I just don't think we're going to get there because it's very thick. Okay, copy. Keep me posted. Let's leave these buffalo, I think, everybody. They're just peacefully grazing over there. We'll just give you a quick view of them. And we'll just quickly go and see if we can't see that lioness. And I'm sure this is the game pass she probably came along. She came very quickly through here. Wow. Unless... It just seems really far that she would have got that far, unless there's not another one. You know, and Texan's seen another one. Anyway, we'll head in that direction, try and get out of this block and onto the road without slicing our skins, Brian. Watch out. Or removing the sump from the bottom of Wendy's undercarriage. The one really good thing about Wendy, this car, everyone, is the fact that she's got a great big steel bar on the front of her, which she didn't have before, and this helps her to win the battles when her drivers, like me, are a little injudicious. Now, I was telling you about that first sighting I had of the Nkuhumas with the wild dogs. They came running through here, and I came blasting through here. First time I'd driven off-road for a long time. VM was clutching onto the camera, many scratches to the face already, because of course I didn't know what was going on. And we came down through this area, and on this termite mound, on this very mound here, there was a dog going, hoo, 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 hoo. Wonderful. I thought, this is a job for me. I think we're going to struggle to get through this particular area, Brian. We'll keep trying there with great fortitude. And keep looking behind us, just in case there's another lioness. The road is not far from us. But to get to it. Good firewood there, everyone. Good firewood. Combretum apiculatum, 1,230 kilograms per cubic decimeter. This is not a block you want to go to drive through. Ooh. Clearly, the hyenas have been through this area. Nice, lovely. Hello, Kathy in Memphis. Unless I'm very much mistaken, unless one of our viewers has managed to sort this out, you want to know if we know the gender makeup of the Nkuhuma cubs yet? No, not exactly. I've definitely seen at least one male. I don't know about the others. And we were certainly, in fact, those first three, the oldest three, I thought were three females, actually. But one could be a male, and that's why I named them Jerry, Kirsten, and Louise, because the Jerry can be a boy or a girl, of course. But I'm not sure. All right, hold on, everybody. The road is right there. Ha 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 ha. horrifying noise on the bottom of the car. I'll be most surprised if there isn't most of this Land Rover left behind in this block when we get out of it eventually. We've got to the point, of course, of no return. But there's the road right in front of us. My goodness. I'm not sure we're going to get through here. We are. It's Quarry Bushes. We'll make it. Well done, everybody. You can heave a sigh of relief. We've made it through. Jeepers, she was running when she came across here. So she crossed somewhere here. You can see the dust maybe in the air. That's from Taxon's vehicle. Tax, have you? You don't have visual, do you?
Sorry, James, come again?
Have you still got visual?
No, I was just checking because I saw her walking into the train coming from the north.
You can hear that, everyone. So she crossed in here, obviously totally impossible to get a vehicle in there, and so Tax came down here to see if she hadn't popped out, and she has not. Okay, copied, thanks. The brakes are still working, Brian, which indicates to me that we have not pulled the brake line out. It's a bit of a bonus.
The damage hasn't hit the brake line.
Yes. It may have removed the oil sump, but the damage has not hit the brake line. You're absolutely correct. Now, this is just a beautiful area. I've walked through here. I've walked the length of this drainage line, and it's just so very lovely. So Tax says she was about 200 meters south of where we are now, down through this difficult area, and we can't get a car in there, everyone. Okay, copy. Oh, well, at least you got to see her. Let's have a breather. Oh, it was elephant dung, was it? Well done, Brian.
Thank you. A fine sighting
of a big pile of elephant dung. It might be worth just sitting here for a little while to see if she doesn't pop out.
Hello,
yeah, I think Texan's going to give it up as well. Oh well, c'est la vie. It's what happens, Brian, you know. Sometimes you win, sometimes you don't win. No.
Such is life.
Such is life. And associated cliches.
Yes.
Michelle, you say the lioness must be Karula's cousin because you see her on the damn cam and then she's gone. It's exactly what's happened. She's in this thick stuff here. Somewhere. And I mean, it would be worth driving in here if we could get a car in, but I don't think we can get a car in here and get it out again. Still, there we are. We give it a good time. What we'll do now, I think, everyone, is we'll probably drive down Hyena Road and just see if she doesn't pop out there. So we've got Mvubu Road, which she started on. We came across the Gowrie cut line after, clearing a fairly large swathe of bush. And the next road along is called Hyena Road. But I think she's in the middle here. This is the perfect place to keep your cubs. If you've got little cubs, this drainage system here is wonderful. Because there are lots of little caves and thick places of bush where you can hide them. I'm just asking Tax where she's been. I just said to him, did you not go in on foot? He said, Lioness on foot in bush this thick is not fun. If she's got babies. Yeah, I'm afraid it's just too thick in there. He reckons she's pretty close by. I'll see if I can get... We'll just see if we... Is there isn't a very convenient path in here. But if you look through here, to get to the edge of the drainage, I think will be nightmarish. So I think we'll just carry on. Oh, well. At least you got to see her, like I say. Brian, are you disappointed you didn't see her?
A little bit,
me too. And most of you are happy that you saw a cat for Cat-a-Day. I'm very glad. Cat-a-Day. Right. Plan from here, Brian. We could stick our noses in here. Everyone, what we'll do is we'll stick our noses in here. We'll see if we can't reach the drainage. I don't think we're going to be able to. So if it looks like it's going to get thick at all, we'll just turn on and come back out again. But she's right here, according to Taxon, in this drainage system. We might find a little route round, but if we don't, then we'll just pull out. So let's go and get an update from Brent. He's back on Juma, and I'll see if we can't get a view here.
So we've made our way back onto Juma, and I know there's that single lioness that James is looking for there, and I think it could be due to the having cubs in the drainage line. So I'm going to take a gamble, and I think the rest of the lions must be in the southwest. So we're going to loop our way through there, and maybe we'll see them on the move. So on our way back, we could see where Tundi was, but she was just out of view for us. We could see where the game drive vehicles were sitting. Now remember, she's got two cubs at the moment. It wouldn't be exciting to see those at some point. Hi, Valeria from Massachusetts. Valeria would like to know a little bit about the Facebook video that was posted today about our trip to Rwanda. It was an absolutely incredible experience being so close to those great apes. Turn this. And it was, we got the Susa group. The Susa used to be the biggest group, but they split. So there were 17 gorillas in the group we were in. And of course we got to see something that's not seen too often, that really interesting behavior of that gorilla female carrying around her dead infant, probably stillborn, but it was incredible to be that close. I mean, that silverback at one stage came within a meter and a half of us. And his name is Mr. Gorilla, and of the silverbacks, of all the groups, apparently he's the one who can get grumpy the most, and he charges quite a bit. Luckily for us, he didn't charge us. But it was an incredible experience to be right next to those incredible, massive animals. Oh, but James has got something far more interesting that's happening live right now. Let's go have a look.
Oh, sorry, we're live. Oh dear. Sorry everybody, I hope you didn't hear that rather bad word. I was just a little bit worried we were going to drive over the edge of this edge of this block. We found her. Did we see them? Well done everyone. We've got through here. It's very thick. You can see we perched on the edge of a precipice. I apologize, I didn't have my... Yet again, I managed to knock my earpiece out. Well, you might forgive me because we did find the lions again. Let's see if we can get another view on the edge of this rather precarious peninsula. There she is, I can see her. Now, I don't want to look at her, I'm going to watch the road. Road. There she is. Look. Oh, wow. I don't think we've met these ones before. See if she goes out again. Maybe she'll go back out onto Gowrie Cutline. We'll watch to see if she pops out. If she comes up here, we'll find out where Brent is, because I think he might be able to get there faster than I'll be able to if they come out. And of course, it is getting dark now, you know, everyone, so I don't think... Are they going up? Oh, there they go. They're going on to Gowrie Cutline. Unless she leaves them down there. This is quite interesting. Let's see, maybe she's going hunting. No, there they come. So, Jerry, just tell Brent, if he's anywhere near Gowrie Cutline, it'll be a good idea for him to race along there as fast as he can. Those are tiny. I don't think we've met these ones before. These are the ones we haven't met yet. Oh, this is incredible. The sun has gone down. We're definitely not going to shine any lights on them, everyone. Oh, wow. How fantastic was that, everyone? Ah, wow. I think that's it, I'm afraid. Unless Brenty is very close to Gowrie Cutline. I think they'll probably be on the road. Yeah, no, Brenty's not. He's still quite far away. We'll go round to Gowrie Cutline and see if we can get another view as they cross there. I'm going to call it and just say, stations, we did relocate this lioness in the drainage line. She's now gone east out of the drainage back towards Gowrie Cutline with three youngsters. But I'm on the eastern side. She's gone west onto the road, so I can't get there. And so if you are near Gowrie Cutline, might be worthwhile just driving that road. Phew!
Copy, all there.
Wow, that is too wonderful. The feeling of satisfaction is ridiculous as it is, because I don't know why it's ridiculous, but it's just incredible. Now, I might lose Brian at this stage. We cannot turn around here. We're going to have to reverse over this bush. Is that okay, Brian? Here we go. You're right there? Believe we got in here, and once we got to the edge of the bush drainage, we had to push a bit to find a spot, but it didn't take much to get to where we are now, which is quite nice to know. I'm going to try and turn around here. look down here. It's a fairly precarious area. Keep your eyes on the dam cam, everybody. And Brent will definitely...
How far to the north?
Brenty, only about 150 metres or so to the south of the firebreak.
Copy that.
So Brent is actually quite close. Well, as the crow flies, not so close, but... He's gone on a road, at least. Right. put this very heavy steel bar on the front of Wendy to good use as we go over this bush. Right, let's go back to Brent. He's nearly there. Hopefully you'll get one last view before it gets dark.
We're on Gari Cutline. We're rushing through. And I'm hoping we just managed to get that last glimpse. Now, that area where James was is incredibly difficult. And there's no ways he would have been able to follow her through. And I'm just hoping we're gonna, I was almost hoping she might be walking down. Now, the possibility is they might, the rest of the pride might have made a kill. Who knows? And maybe she's taking the cubs to the kill. But of course, it's nearly dark now, so if we do get a visual, it's not going to be with any spotlights. Oh, hold on, Vim. Sorry about that. So somewhere around here is where she crossed out. So let's just keep our eyes peeled. I think I see her. I think I see something in this half light. Is that lions or is that impala? Yeah? That's impala. They're probably staring at where the lion crossed if she came out anywhere around here. Just listen, are they snorting? Oh, no, it's a nyala, sorry. But they definitely haven't seen her. I can hear where James is off to the side of me, so I mean he's probably crossed behind us somewhere. So James is there. He must have been around here. Okay. Let's go slowly backwards. Now, the other thing is that even though the safari might end, the direction she's going, some alarm calls, but she might be heading straight towards the Juma dam cam, so she might be taking those cubs there. If she's come from the south and west, she might use that route to go back. Listen again. Okay, so there's James has just arrived, and he says about halfway between us is where she crossed. There's James and Brian with the cool cucumber thumb. You can see the nyala behind James. So I think it's worth our while. We're gonna head back towards the Juma Dam. Okay, so if she is going to head that way, she might take cut the shortcut here between Central Road and Gari Cutline. Hi, Jilly. Jilly is in the UK. Jilly's saying, do I have any guesses about how old the cubs are? Well, Jilly, I haven't seen them, so if it is the ones that were at Buffalsook Dam, I'm guessing they're probably around 2 months old now. So about 8 weeks, which would maybe even 9 weeks or 10 weeks, which would be the right time frame for them to start joining the pride at kills. And I think the best bet, I don't think we're going to find her again before the end of the sunset safari. I think the best bet is keep checking on the Juma Dam cam for the next 45 minutes or so. I think there's a good chance she might pop up. But it is a stunning evening. I'm so happy. Saturday, Catterday was saved by James and the Nkuma ladies, or Nkuma lady and her cubs. Now someone was saying, and I can't remember who, because I was so excited that we might get to see those lions, and that loves the way that all us presenters are excited, even though we do this every day. But, well, we truly do love what we do out here, and we're one of the, I think, some of the few people out in the world who actually thoroughly enjoy their jobs. And of course, like all jobs, there are certain parts that aren't as nice as others, but I'd say for the majority, you couldn't really ask for a better job than what we do. And Patricia, thanks. Thanks for that, Patricia. Well, we're so happy there are people out there like you who love watching us and enjoy coming on the safaris with us. You can see the sun is dipping. There's a slight, oh wait, what's that? No, it's a duiker. I just saw a little speck of movement in the bush. Is it a duiker or a steenbok? Difficult in this light, steenbokie. Hello, little one. Little male steenbok. With an itchy neck. Incredibly alert little creatures. Yeah, I think James is also checking around here, so let's go see how his search is going.
No lions, everybody, but we have come across these beefaloes who seem to be remarkably unfazed by our current presence, which is nice. That's my head. Very nice, Brian. Did you see I've got a boss as well? There's my boss.
Wonderful.
Yeah, very nice.
Not as impressive,
no. No, were I to bash heads with this buffalo, I believe it would hurt substantially. I may come off second best. I feel like I haven't seen a buffalo for quite a long time. I mean, other than the two we saw earlier today. But there they are, and interestingly, eating those dry leaves. In amongst a bit of the grass. We're definitely picking up a few of those dry cambretum leaves. Nasty little bit of lack of skin there on the belly. And there are about five or six of them here walking through. That lioness poses no threat to one big buffalo, two big buffalo bulls like this. She'll need at least three of her cohorts and possibly a male to help as well. But eventually, these buffalo are probably going to fall prey to lions. It's unlikely that they will die of old age. Beautiful sky, the dying embers of the day. Catterday. Not so, Brian. Catterday. Catterday cub day. Catterday brand new cub day. Definitely actually select, just see what he's selecting. No, he's selecting for the grass. Patricia, you want to know if anyone's seen the injured buffalo again? No. Jamie found that injured one, I think it was this yesterday evening. We have not seen another one since then. But I'm pretty sure that it's... Well, you know what's interesting? I wonder if those other lionesses haven't killed it somewhere, and that's why she is now taking those cubs, moving them. Maybe she's moving them towards that area. I don't know. That's wild supposition, but it's not impossible. Wild supposition is a big thing amongst safari guides. We like to wildly suppose things, especially in the face of a lack of evidence, because no one can tell us we're talking rubbish. We'll just put a little bit of light on the situation. There we are. We don't put spotlights on them. We don't mind doing this sort of broad-based floodlight on them, though. Now, that's an 800-kilogram animal, everyone. That is about 2,000 pounds and a formidable, formidable creature for anything like a lion to try and kill. And that's why it takes probably the four lionesses that we watched, or that you watched with Jamie and Brent, kill that buffalo. I think that they were... Well, yeah, I mean, they can do it, and then we watched the other night four of them fail to kill one of them. They raked him, and they tried desperately to bring him down. Eventually, they were just too tired, and they couldn't move. And they gave it up. So four lionesses on a buffalo, even money. Tilts in their favour, the lion's favour, that is, as soon as there's a male or perhaps another lioness around. And there we are, still very little bird sound. One or two drongos calling in the background. But that's about it, really. Very quiet indeed. Okay, let's go up onto the ridge crest here and have a last look over the sun. And we'll hand you back to Brent. And it is our pleasure, of course, to all of you who've said thank you to us for finding you new cublets. Of course, Brian and I feel like we're absolute geniuses for finding those things. All we did was blunder through the bush and get lucky, though. But thank you to the Zoomy especially, and Geraldine for her very keen eyes looking at the dam cam and then following them into the block. Otherwise, we'd have had no idea. It was very much a team effort. And, of course, Taxon saw her coming out of the out of the block, and you do of course have to compliment the directors from now and then, otherwise they make life very difficult for you. Alright, there's a lovely shot of the Drakensberg Mountains glowing l'orange on this beautiful Saturday in August. We're going to hand you back across to Brent, having said thank you very much for coming along on our little drive with us. Thank you, Brian, for your efforts. Thank you, Mr. Cucumber, for your... think you made an effort. Thank you, Mr. Cucumber. And, of course, to the final control. We'll hand you back to Brent and see you tomorrow at 0600. Bye-bye and stay safe and happy wherever you are.
Oh, there's a stunning African marula, apple leaf and terminalia silhouette on the quarantine clearings right near our camp. Now, very exciting. I'm hoping that Lioness is taking those cubs through to a kill, so I'll be on her tracks first thing in the morning. Just got a very interesting report from the north for all our leopard aficionados there. Imvula has been found mating with a Shaluva 2005 again. They are heading, unfortunately, west towards the Manuleti boundary. I was hoping they were going to come southwest towards us, but that might change during the night. Maybe they will pop up on our northern boundary again. Now, Shaluva 2005 is one of the only leopards I'm missing on. So hopefully she will make an appearance. But what a lovely... lovely winter's afternoon it's been, and it's been fantastic having you all with us, and I can't wait to do it all again tomorrow morning. And I'm very excited to try track those Inkahumas or any leopard tracks that might come in. So from Vim and myself and the rest of us here, bonwe.